Let's all sing Matthew 6:33. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. The Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. The title of the message this morning is Beguiled. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you this morning for your word. Lord, we thank you for every one that has come here this morning to hear your word. Lord, we just pray that you would open the eyes of our understanding and help us to understand these truths of your word. Lord, help us to understand that we do have an adversary. Lord, that we are to fight the good fight of faith, Lord, to totally and wholly trust in you, Lord, and in your word, knowing that we are more than overcomers through Christ Jesus our Lord. Lord, we thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy, and all the things, Lord, that you have blessed us with. Lord, to your name be glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Beguiled. We understand this story, and this, you know, is well known. Those who don't believe the Word of God know this story in the Bible of Adam and Eve and of the serpent. And there's nothing really to go over here other than what I want to preach this morning, and it's about that serpent that beguiled Eve. The devil as we know him, Satan as the Bible calls him, Lucifer as his name was before his fall, and so many other names, Beelzebub, I mean you could go on, he has many different names. I preached this message this morning thinking about Christians today, and how we truly live like there is no adversary. Many people live their lives and make decisions, in their lives like there's no one out there who is trying to see them fall. There is no one out there that is really wanting to mess up their lives and to cause heartache and pain in their lives. But there is one, amen?
Yeah.
And he is more subtle than any of other God's creatures. In other words, he's slick. He's sly. He uses those lies to blind the eyes of people and cause them to fall from the truth. And that's exactly what he did here with Adam and Eve, as he told lies and he told her what she wanted to hear, that she would become as God, that, you know, there's something greater that God is trying to hide from you, that God doesn't want you to know. It's the same problem that parents have to deal with their children in the world, teaching children that you really don't have to listen to your parents. You know, they really don't know what they're talking about. They're just trying to keep you for their own good, you know, and they're not really looking out for what your good is. That lie has been used over and over to cause people to go astray. God really is not looking out for your best interest. You know, you need to look out for yourself. You need to take it upon yourself, right? And that's what people have done today, is to do that. Some of the decisions people make as far as, you know, their lifestyles and all the things, they don't understand the way Satan works and how he likes to destroy lives. He likes to destroy, one of the things when me and Angela were dating that we did is when we'd go out to eat, we sat for hours talking about what we believed. People don't do that. People don't talk with a future spouse to find out what the things that they believe. You know what? And we didn't agree on everything, but you know what? We studied the Word of God together before we got married. And not thinking, well, when we get married, we're going to be able to work all these things out, because that's not how it happens.
Right.
People need to put their faith first, in other words.
Yes, that's right.
But they don't. They put their faith on the back burner, not understanding that Satan is subtle. He's a snake in the grass, waiting for you to step outside the line so he can bite you and cause horrible trouble in your life.
That's right.
2 Corinthians chapter 11. Speaking to that, you know, I'm just using this as an example. We talked about how we wanted to raise our children. We weren't even married yet. Mm-hmm. But we were talking about, hey, I believe in spanking. She says, I do too. I was like, amen, we're on the same page there, amen. You know, God has dealt with me that I want to homeschool my kids. She said, you know what? I believe the same thing. So, I mean, don't leave anything to chance, in other words. If you know what the Word of God is and you know what God has convicted you about, stand on those convictions and on those beliefs and don't be moved from them. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 1 through 3 says, "Would to God ye could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear, lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." You say, well, what is he talking about here? He's talking to the church here, and he's telling them that he's jealous over them with godly jealousy, meaning he's the one who has been teaching them the Word of God, and he was afraid that they're going to go listen to someone else. That there's some new truth that they need to hear. There's some new revelation that they need to hear. You know what? People are looking for some new revelation to hear about, aren't they? They want to hear some new message. They want to hear some new truth. And people are looking for something new in Christianity to draw them. And it's like a flame, a moth to the flame, because there is nothing new. Amen? There might be things you don't know, but the Bible says, as Brother TJ brought out this morning, search the Scriptures.
Amen. Yeah.
Study to show thyself approved unto God. There's something you don't know, find it in the Word of God.
Amen.
Don't go looking to someone who says, oh, I've got this new revelation, I've got this new idea, I've got something no one's ever heard before. Because that's what is people are going to, and they're being led astray. And this is what Paul says, "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled thee." He said, yeah, there's something you don't know about. God's hiding from you, and he knows if you eat of that fruit, then you're going to know as he knows. Right? Oh, there's some new thing. This is, you know what? The Bible says in the last times during the tribulation, there's going to be people saying, here, Christ is over here. No, oh, he's over here in the desert. No, come over here and look at all these. And people are going to be following after all this to find this new thing. Instead of seeing what the Bible says, and it says he's not coming back till he comes in the clouds of glory.
Amen.
When he rolls back the sky and all eyes shall see him.
Yes, right. That's right. Every eye.
All eyes shall see him.
Yes.
He's a, you know, it, when he says he's coming as a thief in the night, he's not talking about he's going to hide himself. What it's saying there, it means there, if you study it out, it means as a thief in the night when no one expects him. That's
right.
When he's coming back.
Yeah.
Not that they won't know he's there when he comes back, but that they weren't expecting him. Why? Because the Bible, Jesus told them. He says, I come in my Father's name and you won't receive me, but someone will come in his own name and him you will receive.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's why they won't expect him, because they're not looking for him. They're looking for someone else.
Yeah.
Just as the Jews were looking for the Christ to come and set up an earthly kingdom. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this earth.
That's right.
Amen. And people are going to look for some world leader to come on the scene who can do miracles and do all these things and teach them how that, you know, they can correct the things and problems that we have in our lives and in this world, and there'll be no more wars, and we'll have peace, and it'll all be just paradise on earth. But that's not what Jesus is coming back for.
Yeah.
Jesus is coming back for judgment.
Amen.
And 2 Peter tells us this, that they are willingly ignorant of the flood of Noah's day because it shows the judgment of God upon the world.
Yeah.
And they don't want to believe that. So they're looking for someone who's going to bring us all together. Let's just bring the Muslims and the Catholics and the Buddhists and the Hindus, and let's just bring us all together. We're all trying to get to the same place. Jesus said, no man cometh unto the Father but by me.
That's right. Amen.
But yet the world is being led by a lie, and guess who's the one playing the flute? The Pied Piper. It's Satan.
Yeah.
And just as he beguiled Eve in the garden, he's beguiling Christians today to believe things that aren't in the Word of God.
Yeah.
Isaiah chapter 14. Damon talked about it this morning in his devotion, that the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. It is the preaching of the cross that is foolishness to the world.
Yeah.
And yet, the truth that they see to be evident, they won't come to the same belief of the truth, but they'll skew it in some other direction to believe a lie.
Mm-hmm.
I had it, the channel, briefly on the History Channel last night before bed, just because I was curious. The History Channel is not about history anymore. It's more about, you know, wives' fables and, and superstitions than it is about real history.
Mm-hmm.
But they had people talking about aliens, right? One of the things that they talked about is the moon. The moon, and these people were talking, the moon, it could not have happened by chance. It did not. There's no way. It's the only, you know, the only place in the universe where you can see a total eclipse of the sun and the moon is Earth. Why? Because the sun is like, I can't remember how much they said, I think 400 times bigger than the Earth. But at the same time, it's 400 times farther away. So the moon had to be the perfect size to be able to move in front of the sun and cause a total eclipse. They said that it's impossible for that to have happened by chance. I agree.
Amen.
But their conclusion was not that God created, amen, in the beginning God created. Their conclusion is that some alien race had to have brought the moon in as a satellite to be able to study us here on Earth. You can understand why 1 Corinthians chapter 1 says the wisdom of this world is foolishness.
That's
with
right.
God.
Uh-huh.
It's absolute foolishness. But yet what has happened is they have let Satan beguile them.
Yeah.
In believing a lie.
Mm-hmm.
Because they will not believe the truth. God has given us His truth. He gave Adam and Eve His truth. He said, you eat of that tree and you will die. But she didn't accept that truth, did she? And she believed a lie. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 17. He says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of what? The congregation in the sides of the north. He's talking about Zion.
Amen.
We sing the song, beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great God.
Amen.
He's saying, I'm going to take over God's church.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Woo! But we live like, you know, he's not even real. He's just, Satan, he's not that big of a deal. I'm going to tell you what, he has aspirations, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And he's fighting to have those aspirations done. And I'm going to say he's pretty much done what he set out to do. Amen? You say, how's that happen? Because I'm going to tell you what, there's a lot of churches that aren't standing on the truth.
Yeah, that's right.
There's a lot of churches that have a lot more of Satan's members than they do of God's members. And they will not endure sound doctrine, the Bible says.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to the hell, to the sides of the pit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we know His end. But His end isn't yet. And the Bible says, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, for He knows His time is short.
Yeah.
And He is doing everything He can to take as many people to hell mm-hmm. with him as he can.
Yeah.
And you say, well, he can't take my salvation, but yeah, he can destroy your witness. Amen.
He sure can.
To keep you from taking anybody else to heaven.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Back to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. So you can see why here Paul's saying that I'm jealous over you with a godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Don't listen to anyone else. Don't go after strange doctrine. Don't look for new doctrines. Look for the old past.
Amen.
And the old ways.
Yeah.
Amen. Because what God has said, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yeah.
He has not changed. He will not change.
That's right.
And you know what? As far as His Word goes, and Brother TJ said it again this morning, if you can't find a doctrine in the New Testament and the Old Testament and vice versa, then you might as well leave it alone.
Yeah.
Because it's precept upon precept,
Amen.
Line upon line, here a little and there a little, from Genesis to Revelation.
Amen.
It does not change.
Amen.
They were saved in the Old Testament, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, as much as in the New Testament
Amen.
And here today.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes.
They had to believe in the Christ who would come and
Amen.
Die for their sins. Now
yeah.
they might have been looking forward to Him as we look back to His coming. But you know what? It's the same faith that we believe that Christ died for our sins.
Amen.
Verses 13 through 15 says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. I know we've all heard this before, some preacher preaching, some TV evangelists as they're called, and they'll say something, Jesus appeared to me last night in a vision. You better be careful.
Yeah.
Amen. Because Satan appears as an angel of light.
Yeah.
And they'll tell, he told me someone today is going to give $1,000 to the ministry. And we laugh at it because, you know, we know in this church it's hogwash, right?
Yeah.
But how many people fall into that?
That's right.
How many people, why? Because they're not trusting in this.
Yes.
Right.
Amen.
They're trusting in some man to tell them what God says, what Jesus said. I'm going to tell you what. You say, well, they trusted in Paul. But I'm going to tell you what. God proved through Paul's life his hand was on him.
Yeah.
Amen? And many times Paul said to the churches that he was ministering to, I didn't ask you for anything. I wasn't chargeable to you for anything. Because I didn't want you to think I was abusing my power. He says, was it in my power to ask for food and clothing and all shelter and all these things? He said, yes, it was in my power, but I didn't want to abuse it because I wanted you to understand of the power of God is in the preaching of the gospel.
Amen.
And you know what? Many false witnesses and false apostles have come into the world and deceived people because they're not looking to Jesus.
Man.
They're not looking to His Word. He is subtle. He appears as an angel of light. You know what? If an angel appeared before us here today, he better tell me what this says.
Amen.
Amen.
He speaks outside of this, I'm not going to listen.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
You say, well, if it's an angel, well, you know what? What do you think demons are? They're
That's
fallen
right.
angels.
Uh-huh.
Right? God's not going to talk outside of His Word. And you know what? Paul said the same thing to the Thessalonican church. He said, if a letter from me or anyone else or from an angel of heaven tell you anything other than that which has been said already,
yes.
don't listen.
That's right.
Amen. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Which is a big fat lie. Right?
Yeah.
Ye shall not surely die. Well, they're not here, are they? Where'd they go? They died.
They died.
So God was telling them the truth, wasn't he? And the Bible says, by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So then death passed upon all men, for all have sinned.
That's right.
You see, Satan knew by causing them to sin, he was bringing death into the whole world. Boy, he's a sorry character, isn't he?
Yeah, he is.
But he's a liar, amen?
Yeah.
He is a liar.
Yeah.
John chapter 8 and verse 44. John chapter 8 and verse 44, he says, ye are of your father the devil. Whoa, that's strong language.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He's talking to the religious crowd.
Yeah.
He's not talking to the lost crowd. He's talking to the religious crowd.
Yeah.
And what does he say? Ye are of your father the devil. And the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. Why? Because he's the one that caused Adam and Eve to sin and bring death into the world. He murdered everybody, didn't he? When you bring it right down to it, he's a murderer. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him.
Mm-hmm.
When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of
it. That's right.
And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not.
Yeah.
Jesus says in another verse that they were as those who would choke on a gnat but swallow a camel.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, don't we live in that society today?
Yeah.
People choking on gnats while the whole time they're swallowing camels. They're swallowing the lies, amen, but you give them a little bit of a dose of truth and they can't handle it.
That's right.
And people can't handle the truth. And they don't want to hear it. And so they'll heap to themselves teachers having itching ears.
Yeah.
Everybody wants, you know what? You can find someone who will tell you what you want to
hear.
That's
right.
That's the truth that people want today. Why people don't read the Word of God is because they want to believe what they want to believe. And so they'll find somebody who will tell them what they want to believe. And that's who they'll listen to. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
We find that all throughout time. But I'm going to tell you what, it's worse today because of the social media and YouTube and all that. I mean, you can find just about anyone who believes anything. And if you want to believe it, then you'll have somebody to tell you it's true.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad we have the good old King James Version.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yes.
To believe what God says.
Yes.
And not what man says. Because we know Satan's a liar and he's spitting lies. He'll spit any lie you want to hear just so you'll believe it. Just so you'll justify yourself.
Yes.
Right? He'll tell you what you want to hear so you feel good about yourself.
Yeah.
Well, I don't need to change because this preacher over here said this. This preacher over here said that. So I'm doing okay. But what does the Word of God say? Well, you get a preacher to preach what the Word of God say, and they say, well, that guy's a nut job.
Yeah.
They're a cult over there at Victory Baptist Church.
Yes.
Those people are cultish. They preach things that, man, they don't even know what they're talking about.
Yep.
Because my preacher says this, and this preacher says that. You don't think that goes on?
Yes.
It sure does go on.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? If you don't believe that those things go on, you don't believe Satan exists.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe there's a lot of people that say in their mind that Satan's real, but in their heart they really don't believe he exists. Because if they really believed Satan exists and he was doing exactly what the Bible said he was doing, you would be working out your salvation in fear and trembling.
Yeah.
And you'd be staying in this good book right
here.
Amen.
You'd be staying in this because you would know this is the only thing that can save you from his devices and his lies. 1 Peter chapter 5. And verses 8 through 11 says, "Be sober, be vigilant." Why? "Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour."
Right.
People don't believe this.
That's right.
Because if they did, they'd be sober and vigilant in the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. They would be people who study to show themselves approved if they truly believe our adversary, the devil, is roaring about, walking about, as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour.
Yeah.
"Whom resist steadfast," he says, "in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever." You say, I can't remember if it was today or yesterday, we have devotions before we go out and knock doors. I think it was yesterday. Brother TJ in his devotion mentioned the saying that the world has become churchy and the church has become worldly. Well, the world has stopped believing in God and the church has stopped believing in the devil.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
That's exactly it. The world will believe in the devil before they believe in God.
Yes.
In fact, they'll worship the devil, not believing in God. And you know what? The world, the church, they'll worship God, the devil, and what he's trying to do. But I'm going to tell you what, if you truly believe the devil was real, you would not live so casually as you live.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen. Right.
The things people listen to, the things people watch, the places people go, the things that they talk about, it would not be happening if you truly believed Satan was real.
That's right.
Yeah.
That just made me think of something Brother Clifford said not too long ago about watching what he says, right? Because the adversary is real.
Yeah.
He is roaming about seeking whom he may devour. And if you truly believe that, then you're going to be sober-minded. Amen? I'm not going to go get drunk. Because, man, Satan could use that to destroy my life.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it won't hurt just one time.
Right, just one won't hurt.
How many people has it hurt just one time?
Yeah, a bunch.
And I'm not into telling stories to get emotional responses, but I'm into telling the truth. And this is a true story. There was one time some parents thought it was okay to let their kids' friends come over for a party and let them drink beer as long as they took all their keys and wouldn't let them drive. And they came over and drank and got drunk and went out and laid in the street. And a bunch of them got ran over because why? They were drunk. And some of them died. People think, oh, it's not going to hurt, just this little bit. Just let this little bit. Boy, don't give place to Satan.
Mm-hmm.
Don't let him get a foothold. You open a place, a little crack in your life where he can get in, he's going to get in.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's going to wreak havoc. You talk about a fox in the hen house.
Yes.
He'll tear everything up. But people don't care anymore. People live like, oh, Satan, he don't bother me. He's probably already got you. think that way.
Man.
You don't even know. He's got his hooks in you and you don't even realize it.
Yeah.
The way women dress. And they say, oh, it's no big deal.
Yeah.
And if you say a woman, you know, You know, the way they dress and all that, it's no wonder that men are the way they are. And women will get all so upset and get up angry. And well, you shouldn't say that. We have a right to do what we want to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's that pride.
Yeah.
That's that pride. And boy, I'm going to tell you what. Satan loves it when you get a little pride in you.
Yeah.
Amen. Men, they'll say, oh, it don't hurt to look. Right? That's the way men think. Oh, it don't hurt to look. You just keep thinking that. It ain't going to be before too long, and Satan's going to have you doing something you don't want to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you gave him a little place in your life. Right?
Yes.
I'm just speaking the truth this
morning.
Amen. It's true.
Ye shall not surely die. It's okay. Go over there and touch it. You see that fruit? Man, it's nice. Juicy. Right? Now you want to taste it. I know you do. Right? Now you got close enough you could smell it. Mm-hmm. I tell you what, my wife cannot resist a watermelon. Amen. If it was sin to eat watermelon, we'd have to bring her up for charges against the church. And I'm telling you what, she would not be able to handle it. Right? And I say that in joking, but you know what? Satan is subtle.
Yes.
You shall not surely die. Well, that's just exactly what she wanted to hear so she could go eat that.
Yeah.
Fruit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
And we'll hear just enough of what we want to hear so we get the okay in our minds to go do what we want to do.
Yes.
And Satan the whole time is sitting back laughing and just waiting for you to do it. And then he's going to wreak havoc and he's going to bring death in your life just like he did in Adam and Eve's life because they let him. Be sober. Be vigilant. Revelation chapter 12. And I'll even go farther than that. The way parents let their daughters dress.
Yep.
And then wonder why they're pregnant at 16. Amen?
Yes.
Revelation chapter 12 and verses 7 through 9 it says, and there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out. That old serpent. He was there in the beginning in the garden, wasn't he?
Yeah.
That old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. Who does he deceive? The whole world.
Yeah.
He was cast out into the earth and his angels were cast out with him. And you look down at verse 12, it says, therefore rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them, talking about the victory we have in Jesus.
Man.
Amen.
Yep.
Praise the Lord that God sent His Son, amen, to die for our sins. But woe to thee, inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time.
Man.
Amen. He's that dragon. He's a lion. He's a serpent. Don't listen to his lies.
Yeah.
Whom resist, it said. Whom resist steadfast in what? In the faith.
Yeah.
Amen. That's the only way we can resist him is by faith.
Yeah.
By believing God's word. When it doesn't go with what we want to believe, we need to leave what we want to believe alone and believe what the Bible says.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yep.
James chapter 4. In verses 7 through 10, he says, submit yourselves therefore to God. By faith, amen. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. For without faith it is impossible to please God. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will what? Flee from you.
Yeah.
If you will stand in the faith of God's word, he will flee. Amen?
Yeah.
Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up.
Yeah.
Amen. Resist the devil. Draw nigh to God.
Yeah.
Ephesians chapter 6. Another one we know well. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verses 10 through 18, it says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." The lies of the devil, amen. The only way we can stand against those is having on the armor of God, and that comes from his word. Amen? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
Yeah.
Amen. That's what it truly means right there, to be sober and vigilant. And one last verse of Scripture. Matthew chapter 4. Here we have the example. How our Lord and Savior resisted the devil. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 1 says, "Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward in hunger. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Yeah.
Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple." That's interesting, because that's where James, his brother, would be cast from for standing for the truth, as we read Wednesday night. Was the pinnacle of the temple. He was thrown from it. And wasn't killed in the fall, so they took him out and started to stone him. And some man stopped him, and another man, a fuller, went over there with a club and clubbed him and killed him. Well, here the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on the pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. For it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. What a liar. Then saith Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve.
Yeah.
Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. You see, Satan was that stone that he wasn't going to dash his foot on. Amen. And how did he resist? It is written.
Man.
That's word.
The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he resisted the devil with it is written.
Yeah.
How are you going to resist the devil if you don't know what's written?
That's right. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Okay.
The only way you're going to be able to resist the devil is to know it is written.
Yeah.
And then to speak, it is written.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Thus saith the Lord. Don't be beguiled like Adam and Eve, or Eve was in the garden. Don't let that old serpent fool you into thinking he's not a threat. He's the biggest threat the world has ever seen.
That's right,
man.
And you need to live soberly and righteously in this present world. Amen?
Yeah. Let's pray.
Lord, we thank you this morning for your word. We just pray that you would use it in our hearts and in our lives. Lord, help us to truly seek after your truth. Lord, that we might keep it. Lord, that it might lead us and direct our steps. Lord, that your word would truly be a light unto our path. Lord, that it would show us where to walk. The old paths, Lord, the old ways. Understanding, Lord, that your ways are higher than our ways. And your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. That your word, Lord, will accomplish in our life that which you have set it to accomplish if we will just believe and trust it. Lord, forgive us where we fail you. Strengthen us. Lord, help us to stand in the power that you have provided for us in the Spirit, Lord, that you have sealed us with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Our altar is open for those who want to pray as we sing this morning.
Page 30.
Nothing but the blood.
Thank you. 22, we'll sing all four verses. Are you washed in the blood of the last man, Brother Kenny? Take the offer.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. The girls sing praise you, Lord, okay?
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah.
Amen.
Okay. Kenny.
Hey.
Just calm down.